gave him a free hand to develop not just a university but a system.
I find it personally very interesting that how it was envisaged about 3 decades back, and we find it even relevant today. One has to remember that Indira Gandhi National Open University is not like any other conventional university. It's different. It is different in its approach. It is different in its methodology. It is different in terms of the clientele it serves. It is different how it reaches to nook and corner of the country. It is different that how it addresses the various emerging concerns of the society. So it has to be given a different treatment.
As a believer and practitioner of democracy, Professor Ram Reddy led by example and truly became a leader of leaders.
My ambition has been to keep an All India image of this institution. We have consciously brought people from different parts of the country. This has been done consciously so that it remains an All India institution, doesn't become a local institution.
He is not a learner. He never used to take decisions on his own accord without consulting anybody. He used to consult a large number of people while taking senior and major decisions.
Professor Ram Reddy always says, work is important, more important. Use your discretion. And rules are not made to tamper work. Rules are made to make things easy for us to follow. But when it comes to work, that's more important.
One thing which Professor Ram Reddy has therefore left for us is in us, those who have worked with him and analyzed his working style, is that to build institutions you have to cross a number of hurdles, and while keeping the systems find innovative solutions within that. Second, to inspire a sense of goodwill among the people who do that, so that that energy comes from within, rather than saying that, you know, a top administrator is asking you to do something.
Today, his footprint lives on, not only in the institutions and systems that he built and shaped, but in the lives of the people that he touched.
We have now reached a cumulative student strength of more than 3 million. We have around 55% of the student belonging to urban areas, 37% to rural areas, whereas the 8% belong to the tribal areas, and 60% of our students are male and 40% belong to female category. We have scheduled caste 9%. Scheduled tribe 11%, OBC 18%, and 1.5% belong to the physically handicapped category. I don't see any other university has such a social spread across the society as the Indira Gandhi National Open University has. This is necessary for us to remember today, to take these great institutions forward in a way as it was conceived and as it was founded in 1985.
You won't be able to find anybody who has a negative opinion of Professor Ram Reddy. Everybody will give you only stories of how Professor Ram Reddy helped him. Nobody will be able to say, sir, Professor Ram Reddy did not do this for you. That was the chief characteristic of him, and till the end he was like that.
He lives in his own creation, and wherever distance education is sprouting, I can see his work blossoming. We will always remember him for whatever he has done, for IGNO, for distance education, and for education in general.
I request Professor Asha Kawar to kindly do us the honor of releasing DVDs of the selected lectures of Professor G. Ram Reddy and copies of the IGNO newsletter, open letter. Professor Asha S. Kawar needs no introduction, especially after Professor Aslam's introduction of our chief guest. Many of us here have known her in various capacities, as a colleague, as a professor of English, as director, School of Humanities, as the first woman pro vice chancellor of Indira Gandhi National Open University, as a friend, and as a mentor. However, I would be failing in my duty if I do not introduce her officially. Professor Kawar has over 30 years of experience in teaching, research, and administration. She is the recipient of several awards and fellowships. Professor Asha Kawar has worked with UNESCO and the Commonwealth of Learning, first as an educational specialist, higher education and policy, and later as its vice president. When Professor Kawar was appointed President and CEO of the Commonwealth of Learning on June 1, 2012, Sir John Daniel, her predecessor, said, and I quote, "I am very pleased that Asha will succeed me. In her years at CAHL as specialist for higher education, and since 2006 as Vice President, she has made an immense contribution, bringing greater focus to our program and inspiring many more governments to support CAHL financially. I am delighted that CAHL will have a woman as president for the first time." Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor Asha S. Kawar, President and CEO of the Commonwealth of Learning, Vancouver, Canada.
Honorable Vice Chancellor, Mrs. Premila Reddy, Pro Vice Chancellors, eminent guests, colleagues, and friends. It's an honor to speak to such a distinguished audience, and I'm very grateful to the Vice Chancellor, Professor Aslam, for this invitation. The G. Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture is an important event in the life of IGNO, and it is a pleasure to be here among friends and colleagues with whom I share fond memories of working together in the early days when Professor Ram Reddy was our Vice Chancellor. when Professor Reddy interviewed me for a position in the School of Humanities over 25 years ago, I could hardly have imagined that I would be standing here one day in this very impressive convention center giving a lecture in memory of a great academic leader. Professor Ram Reddy was a visionary who spoke of equity and social justice long before he inaugurated the notion of open education in our country, because people focus mostly on his emphasis on open education, but not on his kind of, you know, social vision. And as he reminded us, and I quote, "Since independence, India has made tremendous progress in various fields. While its development has contributed to greater production, there has not been corresponding improvement in distributive justice. Opening up access to education was his way of addressing the issue of distributive justice and of reaching the unreached. Not just in India, but around the entire Commonwealth. After serving as the founding Vice Chancellor of IGNU, Professor Reddy joined the Commonwealth of Learning as its first Vice President. As you know, the Commonwealth of Learning is an intergovernmental organization established by Commonwealth heads of government when they met in Vancouver over 25 years ago. We are funded by voluntary contributions from Commonwealth member states, and you'll be pleased to know that India has been a regular and consistent provider of both financial and intellectual support. So what does CALL do? We help Commonwealth member states and institutions to harness the potential of educational technologies for expanding access to education and training, and our slogan is learning for development. CALL and IGNU have always shared a special relationship. I remember when IGNU was designated the Center of Excellence in Distance Education by the then president of CALL, Professor James Mirage, at a very glittering function held in Ashoka Hotel. It was a moment that marked the maturation of IGNU as a distance education provider and as a leader in the Commonwealth. Our regional office, the Commonwealth Educational Media Center for Asia, was established through an agreement with the Government of India in 1994 and generously hosted by IGNU. CALL has since had a close collaboration with IGNU through various joint programs and projects, one of which was the Rajiv Gandhi Fellowship Scheme, which brought IGNU's diploma and master's in distance education programs to many administrators and practitioners around the Commonwealth. In Zimbabwe, the 10 persons trained under this project are considered ODL experts in the entire region, even to this day, and there are many more such examples. Now, some of you will recognize, I don't know if it's very clear, but you might recognize yourselves in this photo from the first Pan Commonwealth Forum held in Brunei. I can see Manjulika Ramanujam and others standing here. At that same PCF, which was PCF 1, Professor Ram Reddy was posthumously honored as a CALL Fellow in recognition of his outstanding contributions to the cause of open learning on the subcontinent. That was also when IGNU received the CALL Award of Excellence in Distance Education Materials, and you can see the then CALL President, Professor Raj Dhanarajan, handing the award to our Vice Chancellor, Professor Abdul Khan. So what was this award for? Many of you will recall the excellent Panchayati Raj materials that IGNU had developed under the leadership of our present Vice Chancellor, Professor Aslam, who is also a thought leader in this field and has a new book. A more recent collaboration between IGNU and CALL was PCF 6, where many of you were present. If we look back, we can trace the seeds of the relationship between CALL and IGNU to the firm foundations laid by Professor Reddy. My topic today is Open Universities in the Time of MOOCs, Reaching the Unreached. I will first look at the context and the challenges that open universities need to address in trying to reach the marginalized. I will then look at two emerging developments, the Open Education Resources or OER movement, and the massive open online courses or MOOCs, and the implications these have for open universities. This will be followed by a brief review of how some open universities are already responding to these developments. In conclusion, I will raise questions relating to whether OER and MOOCs can by themselves address the issues of inequality and help us reach the last person in the queue. Can you see this? It's all right? But first, the context. Since I represent the Commonwealth, let me begin with this map, where you see 53 member states, all the yellows, covering all regions of the globe, from the Caribbean to the Pacific. 60% of the population in the Commonwealth is young people and under the age of 30, just as it is in India, the majority are young people. One third of the world's poor live in Commonwealth countries, and the majority of the poor are women. In spite of all our collective efforts, 23 million children are still out of school, and there are over 462 million adult illiterates in Commonwealth countries. So this is an unfinished agenda that needs serious attention going forward beyond 2015. And yet, there are positive developments. As you can see, tertiary enrollment in India has increased exponentially over the last decade. And another positive development, the transition from secondary to tertiary enrollment in India is 23%, which is higher than the South Asian average, which rests at 16%. But is this enough? Age participation rates, that is the participation of the 18 to 24 year olds, of 23% in India is well below the OECD average of 40 to 50%, which is what countries must achieve if they are to see sustainable economic development. So we have a lot of catching up to do. And as governments and policymakers in the Commonwealth seek to expand the reach of higher education and to cut costs, they are investing in open universities. Asia alone has over 40 open universities, and the numbers continue to grow. Here you'll just see the red dots of the open universities. There are 28 of them in the Commonwealth. And the new wave of growth is emerging in Africa. Mauritius is the most recent open university, which is the 28th. Kenya and Botswana open universities are coming next. So why are open universities so popular with policymakers? One reason is lower costs. As you can see, an IGNU degree would cost roughly one third of what it would take to put a graduate through a campus institution. If we look at this study from the National Knowledge Commission, the British Open University costs half of what a student would pay at a campus institution. In addition to poverty, many people are disadvantaged due to caste and gender. According to this World Bank study, the rural girls from the scheduled castes have the lowest school attainment rates in India. This is followed by rural girls from other groups. This is what Professor Reddy had in mind when he spoke of distributive justice. Let us now look at two developments that have emerged over the previous decade, that is OER and MOOCs. Do they present us with opportunities to reach the last mile? So to take OER first. With the rise of social media, there has been a global movement towards collaboration in the development and sharing of content, and we have seen the rise of OER. The fundamental principle is that any materials developed with public funds should be made available free to others and under open license. Several major initiatives in Asia have emerged. Some of these are our own National Project for National Program for Technology Enhanced Learning, or NPTEL, OER Asia, the China Open Resources for Education Initiative, or CORE, Vietnam's Open Courseware, and Japan Open Courseware Consortium initiatives. Can OER help us cut costs? As we know, textbooks are a very costly proposition for many students from resource-poor backgrounds. A study in Brazil found that for 75% of students studying at the University of Sao Paulo, the cost of acquiring textbooks was higher than a family's monthly income. Likewise, the government of South Africa has decided to opt for OER textbooks rather than pay millions of rand to publishers. Closer home, as you know, NCRT has granulated hundreds of textbooks and made them available online under an open license. The Tamil Nadu Textbook Corporation has published digital copies of about 200 school textbooks as OER, and this is a very promising and encouraging development. CORE maintains an online directory service for OER from Commonwealth countries. And if you look at this data, we find that universities from developing countries are publishing large quantities of OER, while UK is the top producer. India, Nigeria, South Africa, and Pakistan are also significant producers. Open universities rather than research universities are taking the lead in this matter, and the OU UK and the National Open University of Noun are leading in this entire OER development. Now, if we review the OER situation in 2014, because it's already over 10 years since it first started, we find that the number of institutions making their courses available as OER has increased substantially. Developing countries have emerged as major players. India, through its